in the first step towards this project, where we are demonstrating how to write your own login form, including authentication, change password, forgot password, create user. This will be sufficient to teach you the cycle of an MVC project. In our first step, we are about to set up the database and model annotations so that validations get bound to the data entry forms automatically. And we'll also set up the layout file so that the basic plumbing is complete. We'll start this way. We have already created one table for simplicity. You can note down the structure of that table. There is a user email nvarchar50 and primary key. The second is password varbinary20. This one will store the password in encrypted form. Phone, just one column for phone, nvarchar10. You can add more columns, but our purpose is training, so we have added only three columns so that things remain as simple as possible and yet the concepts are clearly stated. After this, we have already added, to cut time, entity models mod users. This one is already there. We have given it a name called mod users, and this is the single table that is participating in our project right now. We haven't added any data to it. This is the starting point, an empty model. This is a mod users, we gave it the name. Let us now start further. The first thing we have to do is put annotations. The purpose of annotations is to ensure that validations are bound to the model definition. That is the basic purpose. That makes it more systematic and more polished. Let us see how to do it. If you open this modusers.ttt, you will find two files under it, modusers.cs and tblUser.cs. I know that the name of the table is tblUser. This is my model that it has been created by the entity framework automatically. User email string, password as a byte, string as a phone. For encryption purposes, we are storing password as a byte or var binary, email as a string, and phone as a string. This alone is not sufficient. I have to enter annotations on this, but here is a slight problem. This particular file, if you see the top of this file, is generated automatically. So if I start to annotate these properties, these will be rewritten, overwritten, once this file is recompiled or the project is rebuilt. This whole story is going to vanish. So I cannot add annotations here. It will be useless. I have to employ a trick of adding annotations so that they remain stable and still remain bound to these properties. For this, follow the standard approach. Click on the same folder in which your TBL user resides. Why? The purpose is that the namespace of your new class should be the same. It is mbclogin.entitymodels because this TBL user is lying inside entity models. So to ensure that the namespace remains the same, we'll add our class to the same folder. This is one thing. The second thing is that if you look at this, it has been created as a partial class, which means Visual Studio is already aware that a user or a developer will write another fragment of this class to support annotations somewhere else. Visual Studio knows this, and therefore it has already created a partial here, which means you can extend this class without disturbing this file. Let us now extend it. Right click entity models, add class. I have to add a class for TBL user, the same name. If you can see below this one, the same name. But there is a problem. If I add a class of the same name through this dialog, then Visual Studio will not allow me because the file already exists. File tblUser.cs is already existing. So I'll put a double n at the end, so that a different file is created in the same namespace, and we always know that this is the annotation file. This is not compulsory that it should always be a double n. You can use your own suffixes. I'm clicking add, and here in the same namespace a class TBL user n has been created for me. I'll do one thing now. I will write public partial class. Now I'll remove this ann. This is the second fragment of the designer generated TBL user now. It is also public partial, having the same name inside the same namespace. I'm stressing why should it be in the same namespace, because if you put it in a different namespace, then it will treat this as a different class. It will not be linked to the original one. To link it together, it has to be in the same namespace. This class is going to contain our annotations. Next step. Inside this, you must create MD class. These are called MD classes. Metadata class. Although this is just a name, it's not compulsory to suffix it with MD. You can suffix it with anything. So let me show you first how it is created. I'll write an internal class public. This is inner class, nested class, public class TBL user MD. So this is a class that has been done inside the TBL user partial class. MD has been put here. You could have put anything, TBL user X. That is your freedom, but generally developers put MD here. The same properties on which you want annotations should be copied from the original class and pasted into the MD class. I'm just folding it away. Just copy paste them into your MD class. And on top of this TBL user, You should put an metadata type attribute. I'll have to resolve it. Right click, resolve. So you can remember the namespace system.componentModel.dataAnnotations. Click it. And here I must write type of TBL user. It should be type of TBL user MD. This name and this name must be exactly the same. This is internally used by the MVC framework to link. This pattern is used internally by the MVC framework to link the properties with the annotations. It is simple to remember. Just create an MD class inside that partial class. Put all your properties there and put the metadata type attribute on top of your public partial class TBL user. Now let us begin putting annotations around them. We'll put annotation for the email. First is that it should be required. Second is string length maximum 50. We are matching it that one. Then regular expression. Here we'll type that regular expression for the email. I've taken this regular expression from the internet. So this is what I have pasted down here. We can similarly put an annotation on the password required string length. We'll put it around 10. And similarly on the phone, we can place the same annotations on the phone also. So these are the annotations that we have put. They will help us in validating these fields when the data entry form is being done. We'll come back to this and add even more annotation. One more annotation we'll have to add. We'll come back when the need arises. So this is what the annotations have been put. You can look up the entire documentation. I'm writing some of them on the next page. Some of them are put here. Required says that the field is required. Range is for the range between which the values are possible. Regular expression, data type. Data type is so that HTML5 support is possible wherever it is possible. Like you can write data type is an enumeration, could be an email or a multi-line text box. UI hint. This is used for telling what editor template should be used for rendering this property. That editor template will automatically be picked up. And then here you can specify date time also. It is also possible to specify the format of the input. In this entire course, I have dealt with all of them at some place or the other. So you can go through the course as you go, you will get familiar with most of them. Okay. Before going further, let us now set up our layout file. Come to your views, shared layout file. This is our layout file. I generally recommend taking this to the top. Although Google and all they recommend it should be at the bottom. But doing this does help in many cases where problems get simpler. Because this jQuery file is one such file on which other files depend. And if you put code inside this render body somewhere, then that code won't be able to see the jQuery at the top. jQuery can be put at the top, and you, if you can manage to put it at the end, nothing like that. We'll also have to add bundles for, let me come and show you. We will put the bundle for val also. This is also required if validation has to work jQuery val. So this is the additional thing that I have added, jQuery val. And in case you want to show date pickers and dialogues, I have done all of them in this course at one point or the other. You will also need to use jQuery UI. I can show you the contents of jQuery val. jQuery val actually includes two files. One is for the unobtrusive and the other is for the validate. So this brings you the benefits of AJAX, jQuery and validation all in one bundle. So as a rule, you can make sure that this file is always included in your projects. So with this, I close. Continue in the next lecture.